So now we have reached the most interesting part of our event. It's part two of day two. And for next 2 hours, we will be with you having India's top money experts. And the topic is money and you. Every now and then, every day, every second of our life, we keep working for money. But have we ever given thought? Do we actually plan for it? And there are certain questions which we already always have in our mind, but we do not get answers to, as we do not know whom to approach, whom to trust. And this is something which you all should know about money, as it is money and you. Now we will be inviting eminent speakers again from the industry, and there are so many things. I will just give you a quick overview of next 2 hours, what we are going to cover in this. So how to talk with your children about money? We are not comfortable talking about money with our spouse or children, but how we can actually talk with them. Then, because of this COVID, in fact, we have learned a lot in this COVID. We have prepared ourselves. We are living a kind of new life. But then there is a question. There is always an uncertainty. How to survive without regular income? I mean, many of us have faced this issue. So how to handle this and how to survive without regular income, especially in these unprecedented times? Leave an inheritance and not a mess. Since yesterday, we have been discussing about estate planning. Without estate planning discussion, wealth management, financial advice, financial plan cannot be complete. And that is why it lies that leave inheritance and not a mess. Yesterday, Deepak sir already talked about Picasso. There are so many cases that we are getting to hear here and there that how money is left at the mercy of the courts. And I'm sure we do not want those situations. Then we have a topic, very interesting topic, graduating from no planning to financial planning to wealth planning. And how is this time to take control of your financial future? So to attain the financial freedom, be right there. Do not go anywhere. I am once again honored to invite Deepak sir to this discussion. He would be having a presentation and open this part two of our day two. Welcome once again, sir.
You just put my screen PPT on, I think. Yeah, thank you. Thanks a lot. So the topic for my discussion is the three most important questions which you should think about. And these three questions basically decide your financial future. We all the time talk about many big things about investment. We make it very complicated. I'll just talk about three questions which I think are key to financial success, financial nirvana, I would say. And these three questions are, what can you do to build foundations for your future earnings and long-term wealth? What financial habits are necessary to have a healthy financial life? And the last is, what financial mistakes should you avoid? Let me answer the first question first. What should you do to have a good financial life? And I would emphasize that you need to educate yourself. You need to educate yourself on three aspects of managing wealth. One is, how would you enhance your wealth? Second is, how would you protect this wealth which you have created? And third is, how would this wealth pass on to the next generation? Many people are so focused, so involved in wealth enhancement that they forget protecting and transferring their wealth. Although protection and transfer, if not as important as wealth enhancement, are more important than that, because if you don't protect it, there will be nothing left to transfer and it will never enhance. If you don't transfer it properly, would it be protected or enhanced? So your job is not limited to creating wealth, accumulating wealth. Your job is also about protecting this wealth which you have created, safeguarding it, preserving it, and then transferring it properly to the next generation, which we call intergenerational wealth transfer. Passing wealth to the next generation, succession planning, inheritance planning. I will not be talking much about wealth transfer right now because we have a session planned, Leave an Inheritance, Not a Mess, where I'll cover this topic in detail. But this is what I want you to think about. What have you done to protect your wealth? And when I'm talking about protection of wealth, I'm not limiting my talk to buying insurance, because there are certain risks which can be transferred and that insurance can take care of. But what about risk which you cannot transfer? Let me just give you a small example of what I mean by wealth protection. There was this person in Delhi who had a net worth of more than 100 crore rupees and he had only one son. He made a will in favor of his only son and he passed away. The will was applied after his death and the son inherited the entire 100 crore plus wealth. And everything was looking fine, unless 8 months had passed. Because just after 8 months had passed, the son's wife applied for a divorce and she took away 50% of this 100 crore wealth as alimony. This is what I need you to protect your wealth against. And these risks are not limited to a predator like this or a creditor or a legal liability. There can be many more such risks. Are you really working on protecting your wealth? That's the question you need to ask. And you need to educate yourself on such possibilities and ways to mitigate this risk, avoid this risk, safeguard yourself against these possible risks. And I am not being gender biased when I am saying that son's wife, even your daughter's husband, nobody wants the wealth to go to a son-in-law or a daughter-in-law. All of us want it to go to our only sons and daughters. So you have this pious duty to protect it against these possible risks. Now the second question which comes, what financial habits are necessary to have a healthy financial life? Friends, please know, your habits determine your financial future. Your financial future depends on the financial habits you have. And I'll be listing down those financial habits which would lead to a good financial life for you. And the first habit is measure your income and expense. So how many of you, before going to bed, count the money in your wallet and compare it with what you had yesterday? And then on a piece of paper, a notebook or an app, note down where the difference went. This small habit has the potential to save up to 25% of your expenses. It will reduce your expenses by up to 25%. Because just by noting it down, you will come to know whether it was a necessary expense or an unnecessary expense. And now, because you are more aware of your unnecessary expense, you are more likely not to go for those expenses going forward. The second is, always pay yourself first. Always pay yourself first. What do you mean by pay yourself first? Today also you pay yourself first, nobody else. Now, when we analyzed the saving and spending habits of individuals, we found two types of people. The first type of people, as soon as income came, they started spending and whatever remained became their savings. So income came on the first of the month, they started spending from this income. At the end, whatever remained became their savings. But there was a second type of people. As soon as income came, they saved and whatever remained became their spending. Which of these two do you think would end up saving more? Type 1 or type 2? And I want you to write that in the Q&A box below you. Obviously, the type 2 type of people who save first and spend later. I would go a step further. Always save first and always automate this saving. Don't leave it to chance. So I decide once that I'll be saving this much money every month, the moment income hits my account. And so that decision is taken away from me. I have taken a decision forever. So automate your savings and pay yourself first always. Third is, learn to differentiate between your needs and wants. Needs are necessities, wants are desires. Needs are requirements, wants are wishes. And today, the problem is we are not able to differentiate between our needs and wants. Friends, in life, you will always have more than your needs, but never more than your wants. And it's very, very important that you know how to differentiate between a need and a want. Now, buying a cell phone handset or a new cell phone handset while your first one is working fine? Is it a need of yours or a want? So most of you will say want. Now I ask a tricky one. Buying a gift for your wife or girlfriend, is it your need or is it your want? And some of us being properly married know the answer to this. But jokes apart, that means needs and wants are very personal in nature. Something which is a need for you could be a want for me. And something which is a want for you could be a need for me. So how to find out whether something is your need or want? Whenever you spend money on anything in life, whether small or big, always ask these three questions to yourself and answer them truthfully to yourself. The first question is, what will happen if I do not buy it? Agar main ye nahi khareedunga to kya hoga? If nothing will happen, or even if something happens which does not matter to you, then it is not a need, it is your want. But still the answer comes, no, I have to buy it. Then ask the second question. What will happen if I do not buy it now? Is buying now necessary or is it possible to postpone the purchase? It is always better to postpone a purchase than to do it today. Why? Because money has time value. Money spent later rather than today is available to be invested to make more money. Always postpone your purchase if you can. And for me, this word sale, S-A-L-E, is actually a four-letter word. Because it makes me buy things which I do not require right now. It makes me hoard things. And the third question which you need to ask is, what will happen if I buy something of lesser value? Is buying is a cheaper alternative available? Have you explored the cheaper alternative? Maybe one rose flower, some sweet talks, and no need of a gift. There is always a cheaper alternative. And people who ask these three questions truthfully to themselves and answer them truthfully to themselves end up spending less, saving more, investing more, and they reach their financial destination sooner than the other people. Very, very important that you teach your children how to differentiate between their needs and wants. Today's generation does not generally know the difference between their needs and wants. We are much more aware about that. Learn to create a financial plan for yourself. And here I will ask you four questions. Do you know where are you today financially? Do you know where do you want to be in future financially? Do you know how will you reach from your current financial state to your desired financial state? And do you know how will you overcome the risk in between? If a document has answers to these four questions, that document is called a financial plan. And please create a financial plan for yourself. Remember, failing to plan is actually planning to fail. And I don't want any one of you to fail when it comes to managing your money and your financial future. Use credit wisely. And when it comes to credit, I have two advices for you. The first one is, just because you are eligible for a loan should not mean that you require that loan. Learn to differentiate between availability of loan and requirement of loan. The second thing which I want to advise you is, learn to differentiate between a good loan and a bad loan. Good loans are loans taken to create assets that will appreciate over time. And bad loans are loans taken to buy things which depreciate over time. Housing loan is a good loan. Education loan is a good loan. Even business loan is a good loan. But sir, car loan is a bad loan. Credit card debt is a bad loan. Even your personal loan usually is bad loan. And if you have these five habits, which I just discussed, you are setting a correct path for your financial future. And my last slide is, what financial mistakes should you avoid? What are those financial mistakes which you should avoid? And the first mistake is not being truthful about your financial situation. There is a financial planner in US. Her name is Susie Orman. And Susie Orman has written a book called 10 Lessons of Money. And the first lesson which she writes in this book is actually the crux of wealth creation. And if you just follow this one rule in life, I can guarantee you that you will become very, very wealthy. And the first rule which she writes there is, truth creates wealth and lies destroy it. I again repeat it for you. Truth creates wealth and lies destroy it. When I first read this rule, I said nothing great about it. We Indians have been the biggest proponent of truth because our ancestors have coined these terms and phrases. Phrases like Satyam Shivam Sundaram. Phrases like Satyamev Jayate. Phrases like Sach Hi Sanatan Hai. And I thought, what can a Westerner teach me about truth which I already don't know? But when I read this book by Susie Orman, 10 Lessons of Money, where she writes, truth creates wealth and lies destroy it, her meaning was a little different. What she really meant to say was, if you are truthful about your money to yourself, you will keep on creating wealth. If you are truthful about your money to yourself, you will keep on creating wealth. But the day you start speaking lie to yourself, you will destroy this wealth you have created. So you need to be truthful about your money to whom? Yourself, and only to yourself. Because in your heart, in your consciousness, in your inner self, you always know what is good for your money and what is bad for your money. The question is, do you do what you have to do, or you end up doing what you want to do? There's a fair distinction between the two. Please stop telling lies to yourself about your money. When you bought that second cell phone handset, fully knowing that either you did not require it or you could not afford it, that time you told a lie to yourself. And that lie could be anything. If my client sees an iPhone 12 in my hand, they will give me bigger business. Whom are you lying to? Yourself. Stop lying to yourself. Your friend asked for 50,000 rupees as loan. Last time this person took a loan from you, he went to Goa and came back. Money never came back. You again loan him. Whom are you lying to? Yourself. Stop lying to yourself and you will be creating wealth. Right? The second is not creating a financial budget and not following a financial budget. You should have an expense plan made for the month and year. And you should follow that expense plan. That expense plan is the financial budget. Not maximizing your savings. If you are able to differentiate between your needs and wants, if you are speaking truth to yourself about money, then you will end up maximizing your savings. But my problem with us Indian is not maximizing savings, at least, because generally we are considered very good savers. What my problem is not converting your savings into investments. We Indians are one of the best savers on the planet. But when it comes to converting our savings into investments, we are not so good. Friends, in life, there are only two options. Either you work for money or your money works for you. Which is better? You working for money or your money working for you? Obviously, money working for you. And your money being kept in your savings bank account, in fixed deposits, in assets which are not working as hard as it should work, is actually a financial crime against yourself. You are committing a financial crime against yourself. don't commit that crime. Don't commit your crime, that crime of not converting your savings into investments. Work actively on converting your savings into investment. We give so much time on earning that money. What time and dedication are we giving in making that money work for us? And the last is not working on increasing your financial knowledge. Your financial knowledge becomes a base for your financial future, because financial knowledge and financial habits lead to a financial independence, financial nirvana, financial well-being. And it, when it comes to lack of financial knowledge, apart from general lack of financial knowledge amongst people, my concern is about two of the individuals in your family and their lack of financial knowledge. The first is females. There is a general lack of financial knowledge, especially the investing knowledge amongst females. And I'm not gender biased, I'm again saying. And second is lack of financial knowledge amongst children. Whatever wealth you leave behind for your next generation, if they don't have the capacity, capability, skills to take care of that wealth, it does not matter how much you leave behind. So your job as a wealth owner, as a person who possesses this wealth, is not limited to ensuring that this wealth goes to the right person after you. You also have to ensure that the person who is getting this wealth is capable enough, skilled enough to take care of this wealth which you have left behind for them. Because there's a global phenomenon, and various research have proved that 70% of a person's inherited wealth is lost by the first generation, and 90% of it is lost by the second generation. Wealth does not continue for long in the family. And what do we all of us want? That this wealth which we have created always remains in our family forever, generation after generation. And this is a global phenomenon, because Chinese call it paddy field to paddy field in three generations. English call it shirt sleeves to shirt sleeves in three generations. And Irish call it potato field to potato field in three generations. First generation creates the wealth, second one consumes it, and third one starts from where the first one started. And we all don't want that to happen. And my great-grandmother gave me the only way to ensure that this wealth remains in your family forever. She said, "Poot kapoot to kyun sanjoye?" Or "Poot kapoot to kyun sanjoye?" The question is, what is the purpose of your wealth? The human capital in the family is the purpose of this wealth. You can use this wealth to create inheritors, to create successors who are capable of creating their own wealth and managing the wealth which you leave behind. So if you have an equity portfolio which is giving 25% return year on year, CAGR, and your spouse doesn't know the difference between a current account and savings account, what will happen to this wealth when you leave behind it for her or him? Right? And when it comes to lack of financial knowledge amongst females, the responsibility for it lies both on males and females. Because as males, we are not ready to involve females in financial decision making. And as females, they are not ready to be involved. Whenever I ask my wife, "Please be involved in financial decisions," her usual answer is, "You are there. Why should I worry? Man, one day I will not be there." And you are more likely to be there because the female mortality age is higher than males. What will you do that day? Please be prepared for that day and be involved in improving your financial knowledge. The second is the lack of financial knowledge among children. Whatever your child goes on to become, a doctor, an engineer, a judge, a chartered accountant, whatever, one thing they will have to do invariably is managing their own money. The question is, are they being taught money management? Unfortunately, no school and college today teaches money management as a formal education. Now it is the job of the parents to help their children acquire money management knowledge, skills, But we as adults are reluctant talking to our children about money. We think money is a matter best left for adults to be dealing with. And children should not be burdened with money matters. Nothing is farther away from truth. So please, please help your child acquire money management skills by involving them in the money making decisions of the family. And here, let me also tell you one more thing. Your child knows much more about money than you think they know about money. Not by your preaching, not by your talking, but by observing you. And if you preach something else and practice something else, the child is more likely to follow what you practice, not you preach. So please avoid these five mistakes and inculcate those five habits which would lead to a financial well-being for you. That was all from my side. Any questions, I am willing to answer.
Thank you so much, Deepak sir.